straight from Honda to Doral, fished a little on Monday, and then went to the movies and hung out with my wife yesterday, but I got to get up early and come here to see you guys, and I'll be back tomorrow to peruse the course and check things out. It should be good. It's a World Golf Championship, as you know. Trump, I guess, is not, we've been interviewing the last couple of years because of all the changes he made, but I guess that new rule, he can't be he can't come up to the booth like Jack Nicklaus did last week, because you have to give equal airtime to Rubio and Cruz and everything. So I don't think we want to interview them on the golf course. So, this is our big run at NBC. We did Phoenix for CBS in the Super Bowl, but then I do 6 out of 7 when I count the Masters tournament. But it's nice. I'm pretty excited about this. I'm very picky on who I represent. When this, through my manager Bill Service and his relationship with me, and then he sort of convinced me through John Icano and Joe Young that this was a good product. It was a cool product. It was a unique product. I like to buy ranches, and I like to buy unique properties that have unusual zoning or historical facets that fix them up. And this one's for me is intriguing because I think it's got something. I know it has something the other guys don't have. And this glove, I don't know how many of you actually put this glove on before. Did you all try it? You know, in my prime, I always played like this, because I didn't want any tension in my hands whatsoever. I was the guy that wrote the article in about 1973, Grip It Like a Little Bird. Some of you probably remember that. Because I didn't want any tension in my grip. I wanted to grip it real light. And this glove, the beauty of this glove is that when you put it on, you don't have to stretch it out. Just the spandex in the back, and then of course the Cabretta leather in the front, it's got good feel. And you guys probably feel the same thing. Of course, the one size fits all is a huge selling point. And I'm just sort of excited about where this company is going to go and taking some ownership in it. You know, sort of that time of my life that I can sort of take something on a wing and a prayer, and I really believe this is more than that. I think that it's going to do real well. It's something for you guys in the pro shop. I own a course in Utah and then Silverado Resort in Napa Valley, where we have the Safeway open now. It used to be the Fry's. So it's doing real well at our Silverado Resort there. It's a big complex, 550 employees. So you guys are worried about some of your courses you do. We have it's a big operation, but it's nice to be able to show it to people, and they really enjoy the product. So I think you guys will too.
Speaking of great operations, we are certainly at one right now. This is fantastic. This is my first time at Medinah, and outstanding. And Marty, I'm telling you, what a place. But I wanted to ask you, Johnny, as you came through the gates and drove up here, what memories do you have of Medinah? Some are good, and some maybe not as good.
Of course, I won the Open in 73, and then I was doing pretty well at Winkwood the next year with the rough that was that tall. That year, the average shot you could hit out of the rough if you missed the fairway was about 70 yards. But swinging as hard as you could. And six over par one by Haler one. Then I came to Medinah. I had played Medinah before. It's funny because the final round of Medinah was like the same amount back. I think it was like 4, 5, 6 back. I can't remember. But I started out with 3 birdies on Sunday. I said, aha, this is another 63 in the making. Of course, the minute you think that, as you guys know, you start adding them up before you get done. That doesn't work real well. So that was a bad thought, But at least it was fun. That was the year when Graham, I think, beat John Mahaffey in the playoff. Is that right? Anybody know the history?
Yes.
I know who Graham won, But of course, the bad memory is the impossible loss in the Ryder Cup that I covered, a 4-point lead going on the last day. I tell people, if you took a good college team and gave them a 4-point lead against the Europe, they would win half the time. So that's how bad that performance was. It didn't help that Furyk, the 3 best players, Stricker, Furyk, and Woods, combined for 1.5 points for the whole week. So they lost the Ryder Cup. I said that to them, and I'm sure they liked that.
times. That's for sure. You know, but I said during the intro that you've been on so many winning teams. What do you think is missing for Team USA? What does the U.S. side have to do to become more competitive? It's been pretty much a blowout for the past 10, 15 years.
Europe's tough. You got to hand it to them. They make those putts. Like Poulter finished off that match on Saturday evening, and the guy was over, right? Looked like we were going to be up by five. And somebody made all those putts coming in, and they acted like they had won the Ryder Cup, and they were four back. And somehow he convinced them that we're going to win this thing, you know? And they seem to be close-knit, and they seem to be good pressure players. Match play, you know, they grow up playing match play. Almost everything is match play in the UK and even in Europe. So I think that they're more used to playing match play, or a little more metal play oriented. But it comes down to, you know, I always say that without a doubt, the choke factor in golf is the most intriguing part of the game. If you don't believe that, you're missing the point in golf, because whether you're playing for a milkshake or $3 or whatever it is, you know, what you do at the end, whether you win or lose, is really, that's sort of builds you up or takes you down, you know. And, you know, in regular tournaments, a lot of guys will win. Like for a while there, you know, guys like Stricker would win the John Deere Classic. That's sort of the lower rung on the PGA Tour. Then they get where they could win the AT&T or that kind of tournament. Then they get where they start winning World Golf Championships. And then you go to the major championships, and few guys can handle that pressure, handle the choke factor there. And then you get to the Ryder Cup, it's even another level of nerves. That's the most nervous a pro ever gets is the Ryder Cup. It's, I guess, because they don't do it very often. Some guys only play one Ryder Cup. And so, in my era, I could have stayed home and we still would have won, you know? I mean, they just basically, we were used to just winning easily, and it was just UK then. And then Nicholas, it's an interesting thing. I tell people in life, you know, when you say things, they're like boomerangs, especially lies, they're like boomerangs. As soon as you say it, that boomerang is thrown out there, you know, and it's making its turn. Sometimes it takes a week to come back and hit you in the back of the head and knock you down. Sometimes it takes 20 years. But Jack Nicklaus said that he threw out a boomerang saying that you guys are not good enough, so you should include Europe because we're too good for you guys. I can't wait for Europe to say, you know, maybe you guys should have South America and Canada. Because you guys aren't good enough against us. You know, I'd get a kick out of it if they said that, or if they remembered the comment by Nicholas, you know. But, you know, that was a fairly controversial. As it turned out, he did make the Ryder Cup matches with Seve and Longer and Lyle and Woosnam and those guys. It made it way more interesting, didn't it? I mean, it really, they were tough. And so I don't, you know, getting back to why we don't win is some guys are made for match play. Usually it's great putters, like Poulter, you know, but, you know, all those guys, Longer and Faldo and all those guys, and Seve, they just thrived on match play. Even Sergio can hardly win a tournament.
Yeah.
But you get him in that Ryder Cup, and he goes crazy, you know. He's amazing. So I would say America is very desperate right now. They've been desperate. Now they're in another level of desperate. But they'll get in meetings and they'll say, you know, last four Ryder Cups, you guys have been missing most of the fairways 10 yards right in the right rough. We need to fix that. And they'll go through the par threes, you're doing this. And they're overanalyzing everything. You know, all it is you got to play the guy and he gives you an opening. You got to play smarter. You got to learn to pick your spots. You know, I'm the one that started this green light, yellow light, red light golf, playing that kind of golf. And that's sort of the secret to lowering your scores is if it's, you know, bad lie with a long iron to a tough pin, yeah, it's a flashing yellow light, right? You should just put it on somewhere on the green or safe side and get your par and get out of there. If it's a green light, go for it. And then, of course, red light, you chip it out sideways and go from there. And you never go from trouble to more trouble. Those are all adages that if you use, you'll score better. You have to pick your spots, you know. So in match play, it's a little bit of that. Some people try to force the issue on a yellow, and they're trying to make it into a green. Can't do that. You can't take it out of context. So I mean, I'm not sure why the U.S. should, I can never say we, by the way, on the air. I always have to say the United States, like, in fact, even the U.S. team says, he doesn't even care about us, he never says the United States. Well, we're not supposed to say we. We're supposed to say United States side or European side. But
I always joke about that time with Tommy Roy.
Yeah.
It came into my ear saying, unless you're talking about Michelle, do not say we. Don't do it.
Yeah, that's true. So, you know, this is a very important Ryder Cup, is what I'm trying to say. And the U.S. definitely has a better team this year. Some years the U.S. wasn't as good in the last 10 years. This year, you know, with that gang that we have with Spieth and Bubba, and Ricky Fowler, as well as he's starting to play, and Dustin Johnson, Patrick Reed, we really have a good core group. Patrick Reed's got that mentality. He's not a very likable guy, by the way. Not by my standards, it's just what I hear. He wasn't well-liked in high school golf. He was not well-liked at all in college golf. He sort of got kicked out of his first university, I guess, in Georgia Tech or something, and then he went to Augusta. He's just a tough guy, you know. That's the kind of guys that are tough to meet in match play. He's not like, remember Phil Mickelson was it Justin Rose made those big putts at the end of Medinah? And Phil's going, 9 to 1! He's fucking going, what the heck are you talking about? That's supposed to be encouraging until after the match, you know? Turned out he loses like the last 2 or 3 holes and loses that match. So you got to be tough in match play. It's not about. I was having trouble winning in college, and I was real friendly, you know. And my wife said, "I think you need to just concentrate." So I thought, well, maybe I'll try not saying very nice on the first tee, being very cordial, and then never saying another word to the guy. The rest, I started winning all kinds of college tournaments. I wasn't giving my energy away, and I was staying in the moment and concentrating. So if I was captain, I probably would tell the guys, I don't want any of this celebration stuff. I want you to play like Ben Hogan and don't say a word to the guy. Make him uncomfortable. Not because it should make him, but maybe it would. So I don't know. There's not much you can tell them. But don't overload the strategy and all that stuff. Sorry about the long answer.
No, it's a good answer. I enjoyed that. I was watching on television and saw that Jack Nicklaus, who has been a mentor of sorts to you and a good friend, in fact, he was your fishing partner here this past week, held a party for the Ryder Cup team. And did you get any information from him during that fishing trip? How did that party go? Did it work? Was it successful? Did it build a little camaraderie?
He was rolling his eyes, let's put it that way. Service told me not to say this, but we have a generation of the wussification of America. But, you know, there aren't a lot of John Wayne's roaming around at 14 years old nowadays, you know. Little hands, and they're used to computers, you know. Not the tough guys, you know. You know, it's all right, just get in a fight once in a while. That doesn't go anywhere, you know. It is a different generation, isn't it? You guys know that.
You know, I was thinking in just about any other sport, football, soccer, baseball, it's almost a badge of honor to get dirt on your uniform, you know, get some grass stains on there. In golf, they're taking their pants off. They're scared to get a little mud on there, okay? Like they don't want to get dirty or go to the dry cleaners. You're right.
The guys are good, don't get me wrong, but you got to be tough in match play. Just like it was really hard to beat Trevino. He just assumed you die right there on the spot. So Raymond Floyd just didn't kick you know where. And Hale Irwin was the same way. All these guys were used to gamblers. They're gamblers. They liked the confrontation. They wanted to put their rear on the line, so to speak, for big money. Those guys were brutally tough in the Ryder Cup. Because that's who they were, you know. They didn't want to be non-confrontational. And they were not. Europeans seem like they're full of guys that are confrontational. They're hard to beat. If you got the will to win, even some of the Europeans are known to cheat a little bit. But, I mean, that's the way of winning, you know. You know, the late 70s was that way. You know, there was normal drops and there were semi drops. You know? He wasn't the only one, so. But that's the way they play, you know?
Moving away from.
This is Rock O'Hare.
Let's go back to some individual tournaments here. I'm going to take us back to 1973 here and the U.S. Open at Oakmont. That final round, 63, just staggering, still to this day. And 29 putts, but guess how many greens in regulation? All 18. Just a phenomenal final round. And would you put that at the top of the list as far as your playing accomplishments?
Oh, yeah. I mean, that was sort of, I was one of the young lions. There was five guys that were called the Young Thunderbirds with Ford. We represented Ford and Greer Jones. And you remember some of these guys, Lanny Watkins and Jerry Hurd and Jim, did I say Jim Simons? Yeah, I did. No. So that was, and I was the fifth one. And we were all sort of just putting along pretty good. Jerry Hurd was probably the leader of the pack. We played all practice rounds together. And I was close to Jerry, but when I won the Open, all of a sudden it was like, whoa, you know, and now I was expected to leave our little group there and be, you know, sort of lengthen my stride, so to speak, on a golf course than what I expected. And as it turned out, you know, it was really nobody really knows this, but it was a World Cup that I played with Jack in Marbella, Spain. This was the reason why I had the big year the next year, where I won nine tournaments. The reason why I won those nine tournaments was because that end of November, I play with Jack on Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday. Now, not that too many people get to play six straight days with Jack Nicklaus. And I thought he was quite a bit better than me. A lot of us, the people that have been winning or are doing so well, you have a tendency to think they're really good to walk on water. But I realized, you know, he hit a little bit farther than me off the tee, not much, 5 yards maybe. And his long irons were better and his fairways were better. But when it came to the 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 wedges, I was a lot better than he was. And I was thinking, I thought I putted pretty well. At the end, I broke the course record that week. And I won individually, and we won as a team. And it was like, dang, I think my time has come. I think I'm ready to do something. I think I'm ready to beat the great Jack Nicklaus. Not all the time, but in life, we all have that moment, turning point, or whatever you want to call it, that your time has come, and when it's come, you need to go for it a little bit. We all have that time, and it doesn't have to be with sports, it's just that sometimes you get a little bit of inspiration, and it's time to be a better grandpa, whatever the heck it is, you know, your time has come. You know, you need to change your thinking a little bit. So that was the key, and I won the first tournament of the year, the second tournament of the year, the third tournament of the year, didn't play the fourth, which I probably should have, but but, you know, that was that World Cup that was made the difference. So it started with Oakmont to win there, but that's sort of where my career took off. Well, typical Johnny Miller comment to the press is that you should rename the Masters the Augusta Spring Putting Championship. That didn't really go over real good, real well. But, you know, it's just my putting is just in majors that I would choke a little bit putting, no doubt about it. And I was probably lucky I won the two majors I did because I just get a little too amped up for the majors. And but yeah, I could have. My very first Masters, when I finished second, I was only 23, I guess it was, and I was at the time I was 10 under par. On the weekend, I'd come out of nowhere. I shot 272s and then shot 68, and I was 6 under going into 15. And, you know, I was like a shot in the lead. And I did again what you're just not supposed to do. I was thinking, my dad is going to be so excited. I'm going to win the match. And my hair stood up in the back of my neck. And did a 360 lip out two holes in a row. And I don't know how to this day Charlie Cootey, he birdies 16, and then 17 he duck hooks it into that deep bunker on 7, left of the trees. And he said it's the greatest shot he's ever seen. He hit it somehow over that lip, around all the trees, planted 50 yards short of the green, ran up, almost went in the bunker by the green, ran up onto the green, and he made a great par there and ended up winning, which is obviously great for him. But I thought, well, you know, I had my chance here, but I was young. I thought, I think I could win here. It would have been nice to win the Masters my first try at the Pro. In 75 was the big year. You guys, all the time they talk about the 86 and 75. You notice that 75 was the three best players in the world. Weisskopf, myself, and Nick was sort of went head to head there. And I had a bad first round, which was typical of me in the major. A little bit jokey with the putting and couldn't make a thing. I shot 75. But on the weekend, I shot 13 under on the weekend, which is a record, still stands. But shot 65, 66 on the weekend. But I just couldn't quite catch it. I got within one shot of Jack when I birdied the 71st hole. Jack had made that big putt at 16. When I said, did you see it go in? I said, no, I just saw the bear tracks when I walked up the screen. Sort of a famous rope that he jumped around up there. And Weisskopf sort of gagged there after he saw it. Birdie by Jack, he chunked it off the tee, teed up, and hit it fat. That's hard to do.
You would have played with Joe Young.
I guess, hey, I can do that every time. But that was a great Masters, and I didn't feel like I lost. But Jack, I'm sitting on the stand with the first time, Jack's was second in my first Masters try, and he reaches over there when he says, hey, and for second place, Jack Nicklaus and Johnny Miller are coming up, and he reached over and he goes, big deal on second place. And I was like, dang, I'm 23, it's sort of a big deal. Yeah, big deal, Jack. And but then 75, he leans over to me when he says, Tom Weisskopf and Johnny Miller, second place. And he sort of holds my leg and he says, I just want to thank you for making that so much fun. I said, I'm sure it was for you. So you guys are getting all these inside stories here. Jack and I have always been close. We played our first rounds together in the 66 U.S. Open when I was a teenager. I was a junior golfer member at Olympic Club and qualified. And, this guy, Johnny Swanson, arranged for me to play with Jack on Tuesday and Wednesday before the Open, which, of course, was pretty exciting for a teenage local boy. And then, as it turned out, we both shot 142 after two rounds, and it was sort of a good story, a local kids making good at the Open. And I played with them. They paired us on Saturday. So we got off to sort of a flying start there, you know, with Jack Nicklaus and myself. And he always liked my swing. And, been great. We like the same things. If I live closer to him, we probably hang out a lot. He's been a good role model, don't you think? He always put family first. Wouldn't play more than 2 weeks in a row and fly back to see the kids play basketball or football. And I think he's been a great role model for all the tour players. And of course, he's also the greatest golfer. And for a while, I was thinking Tiger might be the greatest golfer, but no one knew that Tiger was going to fall off El Capitan at Yosemite. He went down so fast. You know. Yeah. They say he's the only guy that can go downhill faster than Lindsey Vonn. So.
Some things you just have to leave alone. Do you think we'll see him again? Do you think he's going to be out there competing? Competing, not necessarily winning, but are we going to see him in the hunt again on the PGA Tour?
I sure am pulling for him. He's did a lot of things that I don't agree with, obviously, off the course. But we're a Christian country, aren't we? And I think he deserves, you know, a chance at sort of redemption and a second career. But I don't know, you know, once you get really injured, your psyche is, my dad always said, your psyche is the most important part of your game. You know, how your confidence and what you think of yourself and how you handle pressure and all these things. It's, once you lose all of that, to rebuild it up at 40 years old is, imagine, think of your Tiger Woods, okay? gone through all the stuff he's gone through. Haven't teed it up in a long time. I think he's 442nd on the world ranking. So you can imagine when he says, I'm finally going to tee it up wherever, okay? Everything he does, they monitor every single move he makes and his practice shots, you know, just everything on the course. I mean, to be Tiger Woods, it's got to be brutal in a way. Don't you guys think that? I mean, I said today to a couple of people, I said, if he would just go to the tournament instead of saying, I came here to win, he should say, my game is really rusty. I'm trying. If I can just make a few cuts in a row and build my game from there, maybe I can do something. Don't you think that would help a little bit?
Absolutely.
But to come there and say, I came here to win, you know, which he has no chance of doing really right at first, I don't think. It's a miracle. I'm hoping that he can have a little run there. It's not going to be a big run, but I mean, you know, he's won 79 tournaments in the U.S. Sam's team won, what, 83?
82, I believe.
82. So I think he liked that record. And of course, he would have liked Jack's record because Jack was complaining to me when we were fishing a couple of years ago. Geez, if I knew Tiger was going to beat my record, I would have tried harder. So I said, yeah, really tough, but it only 18 majors, Jack. So I said, first of all, he's probably not going to break your record. He said, what are you talking about? I said, you know, to win 5 majors to beat your record to get to 19, that's a career for a super player like a Sebi. And he said, now he's going to beat him. I said, I don't know about that. So now it's going to be a total miracle if he wins. I mean, it would be 1 in 1,000, I would say. But time's a wasting, right?
And, it looks safer every day. One thing I wanted to say, too, I mentioned the British Open win in 76. You're going to be back there. I want to touch a little bit on Johnny's broadcasting career, and then we're going to open it up for some Q&A here from the audience. But that's got to be an exciting thing, go back and cover the British Open.
Yeah, we were supposed to start at Berkeley where I won. But then NBC thought, well, you're a lame duck, ABC or ESPN. Why don't we just buy you out? You're going to only do 1 year and you're gone. So I don't know what the negotiations were like, but as it turns out, we're going to get trim, as they say over there, this year. So it's sort of fun to go back and do that. I got not called the British Open because how many of you guys called the British Open?
I do.
Tommy Roy again. Don't call it the British Open. It's the Open. Yeah, okay. Well, I call it. I always call it the British. I don't want to be yelling in my ear. He loves to yell at me anyway. It's always like, what did Johnny just say? Is he in trouble? You better apologize right now. I don't get it too much anymore, but I used to be pretty good at that.
Well, that brings me to a question. When you broadcast, it's always very honest, always very candid. But could you go back in time and say, man, I wish I didn't say that one? Are there any remarks that you look back and say, boy, I would have rather not?
Yeah, well, there have been times, but there's usually, you know, when I comment on a guy's swing, if he duck hooks it out of balance, let's say, and he hasn't hit a hook in 3 months, he might be choking, you know. I know the guy's not a hooker, but he hits a duck hook under pressure. Instead of just saying he might be choking because he never duck hooks it, I might say he's obviously really nervous. I won't even say he's choking, but I'll say the reason why he did hit the duck hook is he came down there and his right elbow kicked out, hung back on his right side, and he cold hooked it. And if he'll keep the elbow against his right hip and keep the face square for a couple inches of impact, you won't have to worry about that. So to me, it's a fair commentary. You establish what that he's not a hooker, and he must be nervous, and this is what he did wrong, and this is how you fix it. To me, that's sort of a circle of commentary that is fairly fair, and you guys out there, when you hear it, can say, gee, I've been duck hooking, and maybe I can help. Maybe that'll help me, too. I haven't had too many pros say, boy, thanks for the lesson on national TV. But in my mind, I'm trying to be sort of fair. You know, and everybody thinks that if you say a guy got nervous, That's a terrible thing to say, but again, that's the essence of the game. That is the most exciting part of the game. That's why you love Tiger Woods. This guy, if he had a 10-footer to beat Bob May or tie Bob May on the last hole, you think that thing was going to go in? Every time. How about Rocco Media to Torrey Pines bouncing down the green on the last hole like this and somehow going in the hole? I mean, he willed the ball in the hole, not only with execution, but I think mentally he was able to do that. That's the essence, the ultimate athlete that can make other people choke just by being around him, which he did. He would make guys shoot 73-4 every time on Sunday. Remember that? You know, I don't think that would have happened if Hale Irwin or Raymond Floyd or those kind of guys were playing with him, but the guys he played against weren't, most of them weren't really tough guys, like Trevino. They didn't choke. So
why he Yang snuck one in there though?
Yeah, he did. Yeah.
Everyone's all better.
Yeah.
You know, it's a testament to Johnny's devotion to this company that he's up here in Chicago. Of course, just finished watching Adam Scott get a trophy down at PGA National and heading back tomorrow for Doral. And one thing I want to share with everyone here, you may not understand the diligence that Johnny puts into what he does on camera. Again, I've been lucky to see this on site, but he is out there mapping greens, he's taking putts, he's talking to players ahead of time. It's not just wander up there, get a cheesesteak, and get in the booth. I mean, you're doing a lot of work throughout the week. Why don't you tell us a little about what happens one tournament to the next?
Well, my father said, if you want to be the best, you got to be willing to do what the other guys aren't willing to do. So I really didn't set out to be, I didn't think about being the best in announcing, because it's sort of like arguing that flavor is best in Baskin Robbins, but everybody's different. But I was really the first one to really charting the greens and the courses, and I get down the bunker and say, okay, if I had 100 balls a pair, what would be an average bunker shot? I know if it's 6 feet and the guy hits it 2 feet, I know he hit a heck of a shot, you know. He hits it 12 feet, it was okay, you know. And I was trying to really quantify and qualify almost every shot, right rough, right pin, short sided, off the tee, you know, where should you play it? Where's the smart shot from it? Those kind of things sort of bring things up in mind. Like a good example is at Chambers Bay last year, you know, Fox had to go to a strange course nobody knew, didn't look good on TV, and instead of really painting the picture of these holes of how to play it and where not to hit it, because if you hit it there, you're going to be really in trouble. And same thing with second shots, approach shots, they weren't qualified at that point to really make the course come alive, even though people didn't know it. That's a lot of work when you get a new course that people don't know. Like when you guys watch Augusta, you know every darn thing about it. I mean, that's why it's so much fun to watch, and even Pebble Beach to a certain extent, but nobody knows Augusta, any other course as much as Augusta. You should go back over here. But as far as announcing and public speaking, you might not like Charles Barkley, but the reason why you like him is because you never know what he's going to say. And the secret of public speaking is not be afraid to make mistakes, but it's saying things you don't expect me to say, or saying things that you learn something from, right? I mean, most announcers, a guy hits it 15 feet right of the hole, he goes, yep, he hit it 15 feet right of the hole. It's like, okay, I saw that. What else he got there? You know what I'm saying? Say why he hit it 15 feet, and maybe it's an easy putt from there, or it's a straight up the hill putt. And so, I mean, that's sort of, to me, the secret of announcing is saying some things. Of course, I never know what I'm going to say 1 minute the next, but I mean, hopefully, and Charity's the same way. It makes it, we got him now on our team. So I'm hoping that he'll relax a little bit, and it'll be a pretty good combination between myself and Roger and Faraday, and those guys will loosen up just a bit. You know, sort of, Faraday right now is just sort of taking it easy, which is probably smart, you know, but he could be pretty fun if he'll loosen up a bit.
Before I open it up to questions here from the audience, I just want to say, We're here with a group of PGA professionals, LPGA professionals, and you know, the PGA professional has a huge impact on the game of golf and the future of golf. And I just wanted to get your perspective on the importance of the folks in this room and what we could do to help grow the game. I mean, what are your thoughts on the future of golf?
Well, Well, obviously you guys have really, with some of your programs that you come up with for the kids, maybe even invite some kids that show some promise. Like Olympic Club had a merit program. It started with me. I was the first junior to be able to join Olympic Club without my father being a member. In all the history, it, you know, started in like 1900. They decided to start that, and they've continued to bring kids that have some promise. I used to have to pay $7 a month dues to be a junior member. And so, I mean, that's important to start those kind of, something like that kind of program. The real secret, I think, is the grandfathers, and even grandmothers for that matter, they have the time to get a young golfer that wants to play junior tournaments, get him entered, get him to the junior tournaments, get him to the course, even if they don't play the tournaments, and they have the means to be able to pay for that, where a lot of the families, both people, or the wife and the husband, are they're having to work, right? So it's almost the future to me of growing really good players, as falls a little bit, the clubs, the pros, and then the grandparents. I have 23 grandkids and six children that are, you know, that are being raised, and then 23 grandkids. So all my boys were very fine, top junior players. Andy was on tour, John played tour events, Scott played the Canadian tour, and Todd was the top five best junior players when he was in the junior age. So the secret to being able to take four boys and the pressure of being Johnny Miller's son or any pro's son, Elias, and picking your spots when you criticize, and don't, you know, try to keep it fun, you know. And, you know, good affirmations. My father was the best, way better than I am. Affirmations of greatness. There's nothing stronger than a father's affirmation of greatness, or a father's affirmation of saying he's going to be a loser. Your son's going to be a loser. He's lazy, won't work hard. And saying this to his face, you don't realize the power of your words and your father. And mothers too, for that matter. But my father was amazing that way. And, so that's one way to grow the game. And then, you know, tell your kids, why don't you give your friend to start playing golf? And encourage your kids to invite their best friend at school to start coming out and play it. So, I mean, there is a technique to expanding the game, I think. I don't know about changing courses. And, you know, I'd say play it forward is a pretty good thing. I've never heard anybody come and say, dang, this course is too easy. I made 9 birdies today. I hated that. Growing up with golf, I remember you guys grew up playing a lot of junior golf, or just a lot of golf in general. There's nothing better, really. It's hard to get in a lot of trouble on the golf course. You know, it's really a heck of a game. Golf produces good citizens, pretty much. Don't you think so? I mean, it teaches you how to handle bad things happening to you. It teaches you how to accept bad rounds. Or you know, anybody can be nice when you're playing great, but it teaches you how to handle a lot of adversity on the course. And teach you to get along with people who are older than you, playing with them, and good etiquette, being honest. I mean, just so many good things. You're doing, nowadays, if you don't play golf in business, you know, they look at you like almost like a leper or something. I mean, you have to play golf in business. Almost, I think 90% of the presidents and CEOs in the U.S. are golfers. So my son, because he was a good golfer, he went to a work called Onset just as a salesperson, and within about 4 months, they made him number two man. I mean, the guy's got more money than I do now. I mean, it's like, it's really through golf. You know, really, golf is a very powerful tool, so if you use it right. So,
a lot of opportunities. And speaking of opportunities, I'm going to see if anyone in the audience wants to ask some questions of Mr. Miller.
I have a question, Brian.
Yes, John.
John, can you tell us a little bit about the guys that you used to play against, the Trevinos, how tough they were? Once I heard you speak, how tough that group of guys was as players.
Yeah, I've touched on it a little bit, but Trevino, in that U.S. Open at Olympic Club in 66, I got paired with Lee Trevino and Harry Tosi. was Lee Torino's first pro tournament. And in 2 days, he said about three words. That's changed a bit. but that friendship has lasted all these years. So we sort of, you know, that was my first pro tournament. That was his first pro tournament. And he just one thing that he learned to go with his goals and his ability to consecrate his time and to become a champion. When he came on the tour in 67, I think it was late 67, he started playing in the pro, he got his card, and he talked to a bunch of good players and said, who's the best players? Is it Arnold Palmer, Jack Nicklaus, Gary Player? And they said, actually, it's Billy Casper. So he went to Del Taylor, Billy Casper's caddy, and he says, I want to know how much practice he puts in with each club and how much he practices putting and how many rounds he plays in his home. And Dell was a nice guy. He answered the question and he said, well, said to himself, well, now I know what Billy Casper does. I'm going to double everything he does. And within 2 years, who do you think the best player in the world is? Lee Trevino. So, you know, it's not just having the gift of athleticism or touch or whatever, he's doing something, the best player in the world, doubling his effort. And that builds confidence. There's nothing stronger than feeling. Remember that nothing more powerful than feeling like you deserve to win. Jack Nicklaus would go to a major championship 5 days before anybody showed up. Imagine what he's thinking after about 3 days. Okay, I'm already the best player in the world. I've been here for 3 or 4 days and nobody's here yet. Who deserves to win? I'm serious. You might say, maybe you don't think much about that, but is that deserving to win, doing what the other guy isn't willing to do, is very powerful. And it's not just golf. It's in business or what you do in the pro shop or what you do super tennis, whatever. If you feel like you deserve to be the best because you're hard work or whatever, it's a good feeling, I tell you. As far as these other guys, obviously I talked about Irwin and Floyd, Trevino and that whole group. You know, we had Larry Nelson, who was a Vietnam vet. He was tough. Little Buddy Allen was on my team at BYU. He won 5 times. He signed up like 4 times for Ford Observer in Vietnam. And I think the life expectancy was about 30 days. But he said, every time he had a chance to win, he won. I said, buddy, that's pretty great. You're able to finish off these tournaments. You're just straight out of the military. He says, golf is nothing. The real game is war. You know, and it was interesting. He was tough. You know, you put it in perspective. But I mean, a lot of those guys did come up as caddies. They came up. They had about 9 black players on tour when I was out there, first out there. And they were tough. They came up through caddy ranks and everything else. I was really the first. They called me Clone A because I was like the tall, blonde, first team All-American at BYU. You get us junior champion and just went right on tour and did well. But I mean, there was a lot more to it than just that. After that, there was a lot more Ben Crenshaws and people like that that came out through good parents, got to the junior tournaments, all that. Those guys, a lot of them, J.C. Sneed never even picked up a club until he was 20. I think Larry Nelson didn't start until he was 21. I mean, they had tough lives, you know. They were not golden child, you know. And so they were just a tougher upbringing. You know, you don't see too much of that anymore. Not that that's good, it's just those guys are tough to beat. You know, they're tough.
Any question?
During your broadcasting career, who's been the most instrumental in teaching you your craft?
What I was taught mostly is how much I didn't like the announcing. I didn't think they were giving me anything. I'd be talking over the announcing, saying, how come you didn't see this? And did you notice the right foot slipping on the top of the backswing? Or all these things I'm seeing and they weren't seeing and they weren't telling me anything. And I'm thinking, I guess in a way I was learning from them not thing, what I had learned from all those years playing golf, you know. So, I mean, there's guys were they were good at making it sound good. Like Dave Marr was a great guy, but he said I was on the air for 25 years gilding the rose, you know, good compliment, tell a nice story, which is an important part of announcing. But there's one story about my mother taught me that when I picked the blackberries, I love blackberry pie, that we picked four ripe blackberries, but one out of the five has to be half ripe. And that's what makes the pie phenomenal. And I'm trying to teach that to Adam, to Ann Baker Finch, you know, you're serving out nothing but real ripe blackberries. You need to once in a while throw in a little bit of tartness just to make it real, you know, give some, everything in life has opposites. It's an eternal plan from our Heavenly Father. You know, there's good and bad, there's all these things in life, so to just talk, focus on the good is, you don't learn actually as much from the good sometimes as you do from the mishaps sometimes, right? So, that's a funny answer, but.
Yeah, but a good one. By the way, every single beef Wellington appetizer I had was perfect. No green blueberries in there. Yes?
Rory McIlroy seems to be struggling a bit now and tight with all the weight lifting. Do you think that all this body conditioning and whatnot maybe hurt these guys a little bit? I mean, you were always struggling.
You have to know that some guys get to the top and they're really nice guys. To be at the top and stay at the top, I'm not saying you have to be a rear end, but you have to be really selfish. You have to be a special kind of person to want to just stay up there. And you'll see these runs at number one, whether it's David Duvall beating Tiger, has this good 2-year run, and then it's like, oh my gosh, everybody wants 5 minutes of my time. They do interviews and this and that, and wants to run to this outing and make money doing this. And it's like part of you says, I want to go back where I can just be nice David Duvall, where I can play good golf and keep it simple. And McIlroy's a really nice person. And for him to get to the position he's in, this is my speculation, that there's a bit of an attraction there where you'll get this run and you'll see it. Almost every player I can mention at the top only stays there for a year or two. You notice that? And we keep thinking, wow. Even Jason Day, okay, he played last fall like he was Superman, right? He had this run, and it sucked a lot of the energy out of him. Now he's trying to get back again, but it's not easy to do what Tiger did. What Tiger did in Nicklaus is just incredible. I was the same way. I had about a 3-year run, and part of me just wanted to be a good dad, stay home more, and I wasn't sure I wanted all that pressure, you know. I wanted to be, we have a saying growing up that no amount of success can compensate for failure at the home. And I was always answering that to that, always answering to that. Am I being a good husband? Am I being a good father? Am I spending enough time? The tour is a very selfish life, you know. So, I mean, obviously that's way more important than the golf. So my golf took a, you could say a backseat to that, and I probably could have done better than I did, but I wouldn't trade it. But you, like I said, these guys, even the Luke Donald that got to number one, went for 4 months or something, and then the Arnolds. And the other thing that gets these guys is they'll get to the top of their game, make it the best they can be. You know, what are they thinking now? How can I get better? And they'll or your manager, in my case, my manager said, McGregor's too small a company to have Jack Nicklaus, Tom Weisskopf, and Johnny Miller. You gotta switch companies. You gotta go to Wilson. They're a big company. So I'm using this truncated cone dimple ball and crappy wood they were making. My irons were pretty good, but I mean, my game just took it to the shorts, and you see how many guys switch, including Rory, all these guys, they switch companies, make huge amounts of money, and they don't realize. The trouble is when you're at the top, you think you can win with a rental set, you know. But it's not true. So you make all these poor decisions based on money. And so there's a lot of reasons why they can't stay at the top, but a lot of it is it takes a lot out of you too. It really does. And so it'd be interesting to see. Bubba is one of the few guys that was very shy and we wouldn't even hardly look you in the face. And his wife has really helped him branch out. And he's done a pretty good job with a very shy person, and he's certainly got attention deficit. He's got a little of that, doesn't he? Can't focus too long. But he's actually might have gotten better through the glamour of winning a couple of Masters. And Ricky, I think, is possibly made to stay up there for a while. Maybe. I don't know. He's so cool. I mean, he's like Cool Hand Luke, you know. He's like Clint Eastwood. He's a cool guy, you know. Spieth, I think, is another guy that has always been great, but he's also a very nice person. And to stay at the top and want that all the time, only time will tell, right?
Take just a couple more quick questions.
Good question, Mel.
Johnny, you've always told it like it is. We've got a gentleman running for president who tells it like it is, big in golf.
Yeah.
PGA of America has backed off because of some of the things that Donald Trump has said. And you know, I've always been one person kind of on the East Coast, so tell it real. Very disappointed that PGA didn't support Mr. Trump more than they did. But in your impression, is Donald Trump, is he good or bad for the game?
I think he's good, but he has said some pretty, he's said stuff I wouldn't even say.
I just got my quote for the night.
I mean, you know, the funny thing is he's so used to being a bit of a business bully that if you notice, if you challenge him, he just can't. I mean, if you're winning by these margins he's winning, these little guys pecking at your ankles, you should just sort of just be good etiquette and just ignore them, basically. You should get down where they are. It's like I've had a lot of other announcers take shots at me. Well, I could have been getting all the press that Johnny Moore's getting if I would criticize the players and this and that. I just never talk about anybody else. You know, it's just, you know, it is, they do what they think and they can do whatever they want, but I'm not going to get in a little cat fight with them over how I do things. And so he should be definitely acting presidential real quick. Because a lot of people want to take a chance on him. And that includes me. It's like, this guy might be like a crazy ride at being president, but he might actually do some amazing things for the country. Maybe he's got the guts to do some things. So, but I said, I wish he would clean up all his other, you know, some of the words and things that he says about people. Tell them they're ugly or they got no energy or whatever. He should just be, forget that kind of stuff, you know? So, but I think he's, you know, what they got mad over was the Latino thing, right? I didn't think that was one of his bad ones. But you guys, that was his opinion. So I don't know. I think hopefully he. I don't know. I don't even know who would have thought it would come down to Donald Trump or Clinton, two Cubans. But
Casey.
Johnny. You know, in all your experience with the Ryder Cup, what's your biggest experience with gamesmanship or strategy or maybe even you know, tough play or poor play on the side of the opponent?
I don't think the gamesmanship. The only gamesmanship I came up with was just, you know, basically maybe don't say anything to them. You know, which is perfectly good etiquette. You don't have to say anything to the guy. He wants to beat you. You want to beat him. After the match, you can say, "Let's go have a drink or something." But I don't think that's. I don't think like Seve would try everything. Sam Steve would try everything. Torino would try things, you know. And you know, Doug Sanders, Ray Foy, all those guys had their little.
For example, would they try?
Like Seve would, you know. You know, like when you're over the ball, he might be tapping his foot like this way or taking it back, you know. He's hoping that'll distract you, you know, those kind of things, you know. I mean, just, you know, or play real slow. Gary Player in the World Match Play in Piccadilly. Gary Player knew I was like the fastest player, like Lanny. And he, on purpose would play super slow. And if he chipped up in my line, you'd be breaking the bunkers of the cat.
That's great.
I mean, there's guys that win at all costs, kind of guys. Yeah, you know, some guys on tour that have done really well, like Gary Player, sort of win at all costs, kind of guys.
Last question.
So speaking of, you were speaking a little bit about your own game. You mentioned a little bit about putting and some issues that you've had with the putting. What have you done that has helped you the most through the years with your own putting?
I was over this putt in the first playoff hole. You know, I had this about 8 footer down the hole, 10 footer down the hole, about an 8-inch break. You know, hung it on the lip for a hole and one didn't go in. But I got this putt for second prize at 140, so that's a big difference. 360 back then, 1980 is still it. But this voice says to me, or the inside says, no way I can make this putt. I'm too nervous. I've been looking at this ranch, it was $500,000. And that's what the first prize was. So this sort of voice said to me, just close your eyes and hit it. I was like, I've never done that in my life. I might have whiffed the thing or hit it fat or something. But I closed my eyes and knocked it in. 2 hours later, I beat him on the ninth playoff. But, I was the first guy to pop up the arm like Kuchar does. That helped quite a bit for a while. I thought it reasonably well that way. I'm at the AT&T with 3 holes to go against Payne Stewart. I had sort of yipped it the hole before. Somehow it went in from about 3 feet. Walking up to the green, it's like, once I yip it once, I usually yip it again.
There's an honesty about it.
So this way, sort of the thought came into my head, just look at the hole when you putt. And so I'm over this, getting this right to the left to right, and I'm thinking, do I really want to try this? You know, to heel the putter sort of on the high side, and I'm looking at the hole, I might hit it fat and stub it, you know? And I thought, well, okay, I'll try this. I always listen to these little thoughts. And I knocked that thing in, and I made about a 20-footer on the last hole to beat Payne Stewart looking at the hole. And you know, I tried wristy strokes, hinge and hold. You know, the thing is, my opponent just was, I called him Wood Key, stands for works only one day. I had a lot of gear. I had a lot of Wood Keys all through my playing career. You know, you have to try different things to trick yourself.
Even in the middle of a round.
Trouble about putting is, I played four guys when I played the tour. I had Trevino, I copied him from that 66 Open where my foot sort of dancing around, I had this little lean in low fade. And I had Lean was an assistant pro at San Francisco Club when I was a kid. He had this high hook, I had his swing copied. I had this Chi-Chi low little hook or crossover, like tennis crossover, I had that one grew. And then I had my own swing, and I had basically 4 shots grooved, perfectly grooved. So no matter what lie, what pin, I had a shot for. And I still believe that that's the only guys that have done that since then that I can tell is Corey Pavin was really working the ball a lot. And of course, Bubba does it. He used to play the wiffle ball around the house this way and then around the house that way. So he learned to look around the house and learned to cut it around the house. And of course, Tiger was the other one. And in about 1972, 71, I guess it was, I started doing this 9-shot game, which any of you guys are teaching, this is the best thing you can teach anybody, besides the swing. You just do this series of normal height straight ball for 1 point, normal height cut, normal height draw, then low series, then the high series. You do 9 for 9. I used to do this right before I teed off my last putt. 9 balls, I would do my game, and if I could do 8 out of 9, which is about what I averaged, you think I had a little confidence after that? So if you have 1 shot and it's not going well, you think that's in Panic City? You better have some, I call them anti-choke shots, where you lean into it and squeeze a little fade out there or something. You know, so that was really big in my game to develop 4 shots, and I knew exactly how to hit them. And I would copy their swings. It wasn't even, I'd even say, okay, Trevino, hit this one back to the right pin, hit a little low fade, and hit on the front edge, and run it back to to the right pin. You know, so I mean, it was very clear how I did that. So if you're teaching young players, or even any of you, ever want to get good, you need to be able to hit at least 6 out of 9. And most of the time I get 9 out of 9, by the way. And even to this day, I probably average 8.5 out of 9. And if you can do that, golf sort of gets fun. Instead of playing with one paintbrush and one color, you got 9 brushes and 9 colors. That makes sense?
Great advice.
So I really believe if you guys want to teach and really get performance, I'm teaching Lucy Lee, that a great little young player, and we work on these different shots. You know, she's like a phenom. That's her. She's at 13. She's from the men's tee. She's about a plus 2 or 3. 13. And, just a phenom. I've never seen anything like it actually. But I'm trying to groom her without changing her swing. A lot of teachers try to change the swing. If you guys hit it well, I work a lot on impact and the inch after. Did you guys see the telecast? I'm going to put that aside now, but did you see the telecast last week where they showed the strike and how much the toe went this way and how much at impact the heel went that way? It was dead square at, because a lot of you track men and everything, everybody shows when you hit the ball. Hit the ball doesn't mean anything. It's what happens as the ball's leaving the club. They'll say, gee, you hooked the ball with an open face. Fine, you started with the open face, but while it's still on the ball stays on the club for a pro about that long. So what happens while it's on the face is how you curve the ball. When you cut it, you come in square, and as it's stuck on the face, then you add this, or when it's draw, come in, and that's what Hogan learned. How do you hit a fade and not lose any distance? It's because he would come in inertia-wise, dead square into the ball with a face square, squish it, and then as it was leaving, he would just add a little cut. Now this hasn't been taught, okay? This is stuff that nobody's even thought about. This is how that's how a draw goes out 200 yards and then drops left, because most of the inertia was dead square. So the ball wants to go straight. But right at the end, you just give it just a little toe down. So it's going straight, but there's that little toe down, and then finally it drops left. Did you guys know this stuff? I mean, this is really out there thinking, but this is stuff that I learned by digging it out of the dirt. But that's how these guys, the pros, they don't know why it goes out straight and drops up. I think physics say that's the only way it can happen. If you come in with a shut face, it'll just make a rainbow, immediately rainbow. Does that make sense? If the face is open, immediately it'll banana. But if you come in inertia and squish it, perfect physics, and then add it, then you can hit these shots that come down like a butterfly, you know?
That takes a little talent, though.
Yeah, I know, but I'm just saying that those are things that I was working on, because I thought I knew more about the swing than the other guys on tour. And I thought that was another one of those things that made you feel like maybe you deserve to win. So,
another side of Johnny Miller. And by the way, what does it say about zero friction to have a legend of the game, a Hall of Famer, do an entire presentation wearing the glove?
I love that glove.